there once. Julie.
We're all here for workshop 2D, New Pathways in HD Research Made Possible by HSC Research Funding. It's going to be led by Dr. Jeff Carroll. So I hope you're all here to learn about new work being done this year by Dr. Jeff Carroll and his team at Western Washington University. It's being supported through fundraising from our very own Huntington Society of Canada. We will discuss current research. The role that is played by the Huntington's protein in somatic instability in those models. So a little bit about Dr. Jeff Carroll. I'm sure you're all very familiar with him. He is a scientist studying HD and an assistant professor at Western Washington University as a postdoctoral fellow in the lab of Marcy McDonald at Massachusetts General Hospital, Harvard Medical School. He completed his PhD under the supervision of Michael Hayden at UBC in Vancouver. His research is focused on understanding the links between metabolism and CAG expansion in the Huntington gene. As well as conducting research, Jeff is a member of an HD family, and he himself carries the mutation which causes Huntington's disease. Jeff also co-founded and serves as co-editor-in-chief of hdbuzz.net with Dr. Ed Wild. So let's just all give Jeff a warm up.
Hi, everybody. I was going to say, is this on, but it's super loud. I went up to my room when I got sick of listening to Ed talk. I changed my slides radically, and I put some audio in them, so this is probably going to go perfectly smoothly, I'm sure. I'm also not talking about what was just mentioned, because it's my talk and it's my hour, and I can do whatever I want. It's fine, you can leave. There's two other things happening. I'm here because we're moving this week. We're moving house this week, and this is like the worst part of the move where you have to like clean up the old house and like box up all the crap you don't want anymore and find somewhere for it to go. And my wife is doing that while I'm here. So she's really mad at me, and you're welcome. thank you. No, but I came because I like to be here, and it's wonderful to see you all, but I feel a real sense of gratitude and debt to this society. I got my first PhD fellowship, the first thing that made me feel like a big boy scientist when I was a grad student in Michael's lab from the Huntington Society of Canada. And it was the first thing I'd like academic award I'd ever won. It was like I'd applied for it, it was competitive. And you know, like whenever you start out and you feel like an imposter, you don't know if people will take you seriously. So my first support I ever had as a grad student came from the society. And then when I started my own lab a couple years ago in Bellingham, Washington, my first big boy science grant to do science in my own lab was from the Huntington Society of Canada via New Pathways Award. So at every step, I felt very supported and very valued and very grateful to this organization. So even though it's moving day, I'm really happy to be here. Especially because it's moving day. I'm doing a lot of stuff in my lab. I'm a scientist, like professors will just talk and talk and talk. So I could talk forever, but I wanted this to be useful for everybody and not just the science nerds in the audience. So I went back to my room and I sort of tweaked it and I have this is the talk I want to give because I've been thinking a lot about the history of Huntington's disease and how our conception of the disease has changed and how we've dealt with it. And although it's a long way from there to what I'm doing in my lab, that's what I'm going to try to talk about. Because I think it's important, especially for the young people here, maybe to learn something about this community. And then I think I'm getting old because I'm starting to value history a lot. You know, like, you know, your parents used to sit you down and tell you stories, but they go, like, oh, "Shut up and let me go." I'm now the old guy who's going to tell you where we came from. So I'm going to start my talk with a little bit of discussion about the history of Huntington's and how we came to be studying this problem. So why do we even call it Huntington's disease? Obviously, this guy didn't have HD, as far as we know. This is George Huntington. This is a paper that he wrote that's actually called On Chorea. Right? We didn't call it Huntington's disease until he wrote this paper because no one had described it yet. We call it Huntington's because he wrote this paper. He wrote it, he was about like 23 or 24, he was very young. He was a physician. He and his family lived in the eastern side of Long Island in New York State. And his father and his grandfather were physicians in the same cluster of villages near the Hamptons, which used to not be like the Hamptons, like rap video Hamptons. They used to just be some villages on Long Island, which is where these guys live. And at the time, in the late 19th century, chorea, right, the symptom, the like twitchy motor symptom, comes from the Greek dance, which kind of makes sense when you see what chorea looks like. Chorea was very, very common as a symptom. Huntington's wasn't more common, I don't think, but chorea was very common. And it was very common because there was a form of chorea that people got after they got rheumatic fever, after they got a particular kind of infection, and they had an autoimmune complication from that, and it attacked the part of the brain that dies of Huntington's. And actually, those people would get chorea after they got sick with this infection. And so chorea itself was really common. So most of this paper, which is like two pages, is actually really terrible. Everyone's like, oh, the great George Huntington, this amazing, like, this is actually a wretched paper. Because he's right on the cusp of when medicine became science, right? So the first, like, almost two-thirds of this paper are him describing treatments for chorea, the symptom, not Huntington's disease, chorea, the motor symptom. And it's like, oh, you can give them bleedings with leeches, and you can give them purgatives, right? You can make them vomit. You can give them, like, you know, tonics, like, you know, ye olde medicine tonics that they used to sell from the back of wagons. That's what he's recommending his treatment. It's actually wretched. But then he says, in like the last few paragraphs, he says, and now gentlemen, of course it's gentlemen, because they're doctors, right? And now gentlemen, I call your attention to something as a medical curiosity only, he says. Like, this is just a freak show that I'm going to tell you about. Me and my father and my grandfather have been for so long doctors to these villagers that we know that there are certain families where the chorea that happens in that family isn't because they have this infection or whatever, it's because they have this other form of chorea, a hereditary form. And he said it's different than the kind of chorea that most of you will have seen. And he goes on, he says, it's different because it has a few what he called marked peculiarities. So he said, first, it's absolutely hereditary. So unlike the chorea that most of the people had seen at the time, he said, when either or both of the parents have shown manifestations of the disease, one or more of the offspring almost invariably suffer from it if they live to adult age. Unlike the other chorea, people were used to seeing it had psychological involvement. So he talked about he said about a tendency towards insanity, which aren't the words we use anymore, but he talked especially about the kind of insanity trending towards suicide, or what we would now think of as depression. And so he noted that this kind of chorea, unlike the other kind that everybody else had, had psychological as well as motor involvement. And finally, unlike the other kind of chorea, which typically happened in young children, this had adult onset. And he said, I do not know of a single case that has shown any marked signs of chorea before the age of 30 or 40 years. We know that's not totally true, but juvenile HD is relatively rare. He wouldn't have seen it. While those who pass the 40th year without symptoms of the disease are seldom attacked. And he concludes by saying, I have never known a recovery or even an amelioration of symptoms in this form of chorea. When once it begins, it clings to the bitter end. Which sadly is still true, of course, as we all know. So the other kind of chorea would occasionally resolve, it would get better over time, sometimes a long time, but this kind didn't. And because he noted this, and because he was the first person to describe it, and really in a few paragraphs captured what it was about so well, the disease came to be called Huntington's chorea, and that's why we name it after him. Although I understand there's a disagreement about whether apostrophe S is correct. You didn't actually have Huntington's. Dr. Weil will be happy to know that I know what an apostrophe is, because apparently when he edits my HD buzz writing, I use them just randomly. It's true, actually. I'm not sure when, so I just use it half the time. It's interesting if you think about what was happening in the 1870s, right? So Huntington's writing this paper, no one knows what genetics is. There's no genetics, right? Mendel, the founder of modern genetics, was breeding key plants at the same time in a little monastery in what would eventually become the Czech Republic. No one even knew of his work until the early 20th century when William Bateson, like giant of human genetics, actually coined the term genetics and used, in the book where he did that, used Huntington's chorea as an example of what he called, and we still call it, autosomal dominant genetic disease. So an autosome, it just means not a sex chromosome, right? So Huntington's isn't one of those diseases where it's more common in men or women, we know that. And dominant means you only have to inherit one bad copy of the mutation to have the disease. And so Huntington is sort of it was literally the example that was used as an autosomal dominant condition. And Bateson and other people used it as an example. But this was after Huntington himself had actually died. So it was one thing to know that it was hereditary, but of course for a long time we didn't know what that meant. Scientists are people, and they make the same kind of mistakes that people make. And they made some really stupid ones when they started to understand genetics just a little bit. And the story of Huntington's is interwoven with the story of eugenics. So raise your hand if you've heard of eugenics. What is it, somebody? Said Professor Carroll. Just yell out, I'm not shy. You have to call on someone?
Frankenstein trying to create whatever it is, trying to take more control over the genes.
Hi. Right, so we get that things can be genetic, they're heritable. So what if we just like breeding better dogs or better racehorses or something, what if we bred out bad traits and bred in the good traits, right? Like cleansing the race, whatever that was. This was a very prominent idea, right? The founder of the American eugenics movement was the head of he was at Harvard Medical School. He went and founded Cold Spring Harbor Laboratories in, ironically, Long Island, where George Huntington had studied those same families. Charles Davenport, the founder of the American Eugenics Movement, published papers about Huntington's disease families, sent his research associates out to map the pedigrees of Huntington's disease families, recommending that they avoid transmission of the disease, and couldn't understand why people wouldn't take his advice to stop breeding. So if your solution for a social problem is to get people to stop having sex, it's probably not going to work. So this paper is published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of the Sciences of the United States, still one of the most prominent journals in the world, right? This speculation of why won't these people just stop breeding. So this was not good, obviously. This is 1920s or so. Inspired by the Americans, not the other way around, the Nazis, when they took over Germany in 1933, in the first year they were in power, not 1945, 1933, they passed a law listing, these are Germans, so there's a list, listing the categories of people that the state could legally forcibly sterilize, right? And it includes the categories of genetic disease. Number 5 of 8 is hereditary chorea, or Huntington's chorea. So they were literally taking Huntington's patients and sterilizing them without their consent. Of course, before long, they were actually killing them outright. But this is 1933, right? This is what happens when a little bit of science gets understood and applied in a very terrible way. It's interesting, too, because as you look at this, there's categories of things on here that are not hereditary. So they didn't even understand enough genetics to get their horrible Nazi laws right. They just, whatever. Nazis are not good, that's the point of this slide. But they weren't alone. They were actually inspired by laws in California. I'm sorry to be US-centric here. I am really Canadian. I've just been away for a while. The Nazis were in constant communication, people who wrote these laws were in constant communication with people in America. People like Paul Papineau, who founded something called the Human Betterment Foundation in California. He had this rich millionaire who gave him all this money to found this foundation to study heredity, including things like Huntington's. He always signed off his papers as Dr. Papineau, the guy who wrote all this stuff in the US and California, but he didn't actually have a degree. He wasn't really a scientist. He had an honorary degree. He had been a fig farmer or something really strange. So here he's writing about sterilization for human betterment. This is not ironic. This is him saying how great the world's going to be when we sterilize people like Huntington's disease patients. He writes in a publication, an American publication, published in California, this glowing review of the Nazi law of 1933. And throughout, he adoringly cites Mein Kampf, the book that Hitler wrote when he was in jail. It's so weird to see an American intellectual, heavy quotes, citing Hitler, admiringly talking about sterilizing people with genetic disease. And these people were influential. They got sterilization laws passed in many states in the United States. So I'm using California as an example here because everybody's always nice to California, so let's pick on them a little bit. In 1909, they passed a sterilization law. In 1913, they have a state lunacy commission that has the dictatorial right to forcibly sterilize people that they think should be sterilized, including Pete Huntington's patients. It wasn't rare. They sterilized tens of thousands of people over the year. In 1927, the US Supreme Court decided 8-1 that it is better for all the world if instead of waiting to execute degenerate offspring for crime or let them starve for their imbecility, society can prevent those who are manifestly unfit from continuing their kind. This decision has never been overturned. This is still, the in theory, the last time the Supreme Court has spoken up about the forcible sterilization of people like us. That was written by Oliver Wendell Holmes, by the way. So for the history nerds in the audience, he's like an incredibly famous American jurist, right? Wrote this kind of nonsense. And it wasn't until after the like worst things in the Nazi regime that this got unpopular again, thank God. In 1951, the law was amended to actually make it that you had to ask people before you cut out their spits. For people who like fun history stories, that's Dr. Paul Papineau describing genetics to like a really befuddled color.
No kidding.
The really funny thing about this picture, well there's many funny things about this picture. One is that, once again, it's Dr. Papineau. And one is that the trait that he's describing, the genetic trait that he's describing to these people is black people of artistic ability.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So anyway, that was his scientific rigor. And after World War II, it wasn't cool to be a eugenicist anymore, so he had to find another job. So who's seen this magazine around? The longest running column that has ever been in the Ladies Home Journal, which is still like, you know, publication, was called Can This Marriage Be Saved? And it was like the Dan Savage of the 50s or whatever. It was like people would write in with their marital problems and Dr. Papineau would give them advice. He ran the column, he was the longest running columnist ever for the Ladies Home Journal until like the 70s when he retired. So good guy all around. Actually, who's heard of this guy? This is an American-centric thing. I'm sorry, James Dobson, Focus on the Family in the US, kind of like a right-wing think tank in the US. His first job out of college was being a secretary for Paul Papineau at the Ladies Home Journal. And then he went on to try to ruin American politics. Anyway, moving back to HD. So that's cool, because all this terrible stuff happened, and then we, as a community, I think rebelled against that. And I think when we sort of like hold ourselves up to say, you know, how we thought about ourselves, and maybe we should stop sterilizing our brothers and sisters, please. People like Marjorie Guthrie, decided to kind of fight back, and I'm so inspired by that because the way those things ricochet through history are super interesting. So Marjorie Guthrie, shown here with her husband Woody, of course, and shown being his caregiver, famously founded in the U.S. the Committee to Combat Huntington's Disease, the first kind of patient-led effort to fight back against Huntington's and to find a space for us in the debate, you know, beyond calling us imbeciles and sterilizing us. Marjorie got to know a senator from Massachusetts named Ted Kennedy in her work in the Senate at the Committee to Combat Huntington's Disease. And in about 1980, a South African doctor who was having political problems but who was interested in studying Huntington's disease needed to escape South Africa and come to the US initially and study. And she got her buddy Ted Kennedy to write a letter supporting Michael Hayden's immigration visa to come to the United States, where he went to Harvard initially before he came to UBC, where I came to work with him. So were it not for her like courage, you know, and foresight and kindness to the people around her with no idea of what the payoff would be, I definitely wouldn't be here. And it's clear that Michael probably wouldn't have gotten into the US, and we would have all lost a lot. So things got better is the point. They didn't unfortunately get better for Woody. This is some lyrics that Nora Guthrie, Woody's daughter, sent me that I always like to show people, because it shows that even when people are really sick, they can keep their sense of humor. And I think Huntington's families know this intuitively, but it's beautiful to see it. So Woody Guthrie had a really beautiful handwriting, like perfect, square, weird little handwriting. And he wrote a song every day. He wrote songs about brushing his teeth. He wrote songs about pretty nurses. He wrote songs about changing his underwear, whatever. Every day he wrote songs. And when he was institutionalized in Brooklyn State Hospital there, he kept writing songs, but his handwriting was so bad by now, because you can see his this is his signature, but someone had typed it, probably Marjorie had typed it for him. And he called this song My Korea Yia Yia. And he says, I don't have to pay you barman a dime. My whole Korea makes me dizzy all the time. God makes all kinds of sickness and misery, and Korea fits me just fine. I think it's really sweet. This is a picture of the hospital. I'm gonna try to play audio. This is probably gonna be a disaster, but just smile. I won't play the whole thing.
There's this book coming out, and they asked me to write something about Woody. You know, sort of like, what does Woody Guthrie mean to you in 25 words?
This is Bob Dylan, recent laureate, no, whatever. What do you mean?
No, for
what?
Literature.
This is the one time he read this poem aloud, which was in 1963, which was a 5-page reflection on Woody Guthrie. And I'm gonna play you just a minute of it, because I think it's just neat.
There's this book coming out, and they asked me to write something about Woody. Sort of like, what does Woody Guthrie mean to you in 25 words? And I couldn't do it. I wrote out 5 pages, and I have it here. It's that was there by accident, actually. But I'd like to say this out loud. So, if you can sort of roll along with this thing here. This is called Last Thoughts on Woody Guthrie. When your head gets twisted and your mind grows numb, when you think you're too old, too young, too smart, too dumb, when you're lagging behind and losing your pace in a slow motion crawl or life's busy race, no matter what you're doing, if you start giving up, there's a line don't come to the top of your cup. If the wind guides you sideways with one hand holding on, the other starts slipping on the feeling of God. And your train engine fire and your new spark to catch it, the wood's easy fine, but you're lazy to fetch it. And you side.
He really does go on for about 7 minutes. It's amazing. I'm going to just skip ahead if I can, because there's, he said something about Woody that I think is really sweet.
Kicks get out of quick and make all kinds of money and chicks. And you yell to yourself and you throw down your hat, saying, Christ, do I got to be like that? Ain't there no one here that knows where I'm at? Ain't there no one here that knows how I feel? Good God Almighty, that stuff ain't real. No, but that ain't your game, it ain't your race. You can't hear your name, you can't see your face. You got to look some other place. And where do you look for this hope that you're seeking? Where do you look for this lamp that's burning? Where do you look for this oil well gushing? Where do you look for this candle that's glowing? Where do you look for this hope that you know is there and out there somewhere? And your feet can only walk down 2 kinds of roads. Your eyes can only look through 2 kinds of windows. Your nose can only smell 2 kinds of hallways. You can touch and twist and turn 2 kinds of doorknobs. You can either go to the church of your choice or you go to Brooklyn State Hospital. You find God in the church of your choice, you find Woody Guthrie in Brooklyn State Hospital. And that's only my opinion, I'm either right or wrong. You find them both in Grand Canyon, sundown.
It's really sweet, you should listen to the whole thing. So, that's the hospital. They left the hospital there. They just let it decay, they left all the records sitting there. Phil Buell, this amazing American photographer, went and found Woody's like file in just like a cabinet in this like decrepit, creepy old hospital. It was incredible. So that was, you know, the suffering of Woody though led to Marjorie getting involved and doing her amazing work that culminated in the founding of the Huntington Disease Society of America. And of course, that had reverberations here too. I love this picture, by the way. It's so sweet. This had reverberations here, right? I think, Erin, didn't you talk to Marjorie early on here?
Pardon me?
Didn't you talk to Marjorie early on?
Oh, yes. She came to Toronto and spent time with us.
Everyone I've ever talked to about Marjorie said, we called her and we said we didn't know what to do, and she got on a plane and flew down. Like, just incredible. And you think about, you know, you guys starting in the 70s and this small group, and now, you know, look at us. And God, I wish we didn't have to be here. But given that we do, I'm glad that we're here together. Okay, that's my old man history rant, sorry. So all you young whippersnappers, the test will be at the end. So let's go back to science, so finish that part of the talk at some point. What time am I supposed to be done? 2:40? Down the front. Okay, so this is what, this is what, I don't need to show you guys this, but this is what clinicians think about when they look at Huntington's disease. You know, they see a patient who's got these twitchy movements. He's counting backwards.
97.
Can you kill the volume? And, you know, we're all familiar with this. Along with the gait, we've got something called motor impersistence. They used to call this milkmaid's grip. I don't know if you guys know that. Because people who have Huntington's would squeeze your hand and let go of it when they shook it, because they would have a hard time like holding and shaking. That's called motor impersistence. So impaired fine motor control, we all know these things. What's not shown in these kind of videos is, of course, what we all know is the more problematic part of this disease, which is the difficulties in thinking, right? And the difficulties with mood regulation, which I think are much more damaging for most families than just these movement symptoms, which, you know, are troublesome, but not as bad as not remembering your kids. So where does that come from? This is a slide that, like, I don't even know where it came from. We've been stealing it from each other for so long. This is a slice of a human brain. This is a control, it's a Huntington's disease patient. I show this to my undergrads and I say, you know, which brain would you rather have? There's not really any confusion about it. It's pretty clear that the Huntington's disease brain is shrunken and there's some atrophy that's happening. The whole brain shrinks, which is true. But what you really notice is what one of my students called the butterflies in the middle, right? These big holes in the middle. These are called ventricles. These specifically are called the lateral ventricles. And they look like they grew, but they didn't. It's just because the tissue underneath of them shrunk. So these little bits of tissue here, collectively called the striatum, are basically gone. So by the time someone dies of Huntington's disease, their whole brain has shrunk a bit, but that particular part of their brain is essentially gone. So I'm like a hardcore materialist neuroscientist guy, and so I think that everything we saw in the first video, right, all the movement symptoms, the mood problems, the thinking problems, come from this bit of the brain being really severely broken. It's an interesting bit of the brain because 95% of the cells in it, of the brain cells in it, are of one type. So sometimes in some parts of the brain, there's lots of different types of brain cells working together. Here in this part of the brain called the striatum, there's basically one kind of brain cell, one kind of neuron to be specific, and they're called a medium spiny neuron because they're like medium size and because they look spiny, basically. That's how we name things. These cells basically disappear from the brain of someone who dies of Huntington's disease. So more than 95% on average of these cells are missing by the time someone dies of the normal course of Huntington's disease, the normal course of Huntington's disease. Why is this happening? Huntington knew that it was hereditary. In the early 80s, Jim Cusella, Nancy Wexler, and other people used large families of Huntington's disease, and at the time, like, brand new techniques. You have to appreciate, I'm back on the history thing, sorry. Huntington's was the first human disease to be able to call positionally cloned. So that most human diseases at that time, that were genetic, it was kind of like, we know they're genetic, but we don't know which bit of the genome is bad. Huntington's disease was the first human disease where someone said, boom, it's on chromosome 4. That's still a big chunk of the genome, right? It's still 5% of the whole genome, but it's like, we knew, and that never happened before. That was due to a long time study of these huge families, both in North America and in Venezuela. And also the kind of audacity of a young investigator, Jim Guzella, to do something that everyone who was senior to him told him was impossible. And I think it's incredible. It took, of course, 10 more years to zoom in, right? Which is really frustrating because today I can just go log on to a genome browser and we can do it, right? Like it's like Google Maps. We can just keep going until we're like, boop, there's a Huntington gene, no problem. They didn't have it at the time. This is pre-human genome. So it took 10 years before Jim and the rest of the Nancy and the rest of the collaborative research team actually found a gene that causes Huntington's disease. So this, of course, was profoundly changed all of our world. And when they found it, the gene, they found that there's four letters of DNA. People remember A, T, G, and C, and hopefully people remember that the Huntington's disease gene has this repetitive sequence, the CAG, CAG, CAG. In even normal people, I can say normal because I'm HD. In normal people without an HD mutation, in their copies of their HD gene, the one they got from mom and the one they got from dad, there's about 17 of these CAGs in a row. It's already repetitive. Does anybody know why? I don't either. No one has any idea. It's like 17 CAGs in humans, it's like 7 CAGs in mice, it's 4 CAGs in fish, it's 1 CAG in a sea urchin. A sea urchin has a Huntington gene, has 1 CAG in it. So something about evolution made us get bigger CAGs, and we don't know why. And it turns out the more bigger, the worse, basically. Or to quote Donald Trump, the more bigly, the worse. More CAGs is more bad. If you have longer CAG tracts, you get Huntington's disease earlier, on average. And above a certain threshold, if you inherit that many CAGs in one of your copies of HD gene, you'll get Huntington's if you live long enough. This is what my students always say, what do I need to know for the test? So for my science refresher, our best understanding of Huntington's is an autosomal dominant genetic brain disease. It's caused by an expanded CAG tract in this HD gene. The gene codes, having said this, the gene codes for a protein, that's what most genes do. It makes a protein, a little machine or cell that does stuff. And that protein is screwed up and it does bad stuff to cells. The bad stuff is especially bad for reasons we don't understand to these specific neurons in a specific part of the brain, and when they die, you get symptoms. That's 30 years of HD research in one paragraph. So you're gonna say, okay, scientist guy, why haven't we fixed this yet? What's the problem? Like, it's been 20 years or more since the gene was cloned, what's happening? That's a coanoflagellate, if you're wondering. Probably going like a pond, you know, like when you're a kid, you ever look at pond water like under a microscope in science class. That's one of those little single-celled paramecium-looking guys that's got the little tail. They have a Huntington gene. Dicastelium, a clonal slime mold that lives in moss in the rain, an amoeba, literally an amoeba, has a Huntington gene. If you get rid of their Huntington gene, they get screwed up. You can take human Huntington gene and put it in a slime mold, and it fixes them. Hundreds of millions of years of evolution, and this gene is still critically. So anything that's present in a slime mold and us is probably pretty important. Yeah, Huntington's important. This is kind of, this is sort of science-y, sorry, but the other thing is, like, so you inherit this gene, but you have lots of different cells in your body. Like, maybe those cells in the brain that die are dying because they're the only ones that turn on that particular gene, right? They turn on this Huntington gene. Because your toe cells don't make brain stuff, and your brain cells don't make toe stuff. Like, that's important if you want to have tissue. Unfortunately, so this is what it looks like. This is these are like a bunch of different tissues from people, and they're looking at what is a gene turned on or not in that tissue. The top gene here is a brain cell gene, and all these yellow tissues are just different brain regions. And so this gene looks like it's only important for the brain, it's only turned on in the brain. This is the Huntington gene. It's super boring. It's everywhere. Your red blood cells, which are these like stripped down little bags of hemoglobin, whose only job is to get oxygen to your tissues, they still have a Huntington protein in them. It's everywhere. It's huge. So exons, doesn't matter, exons are like the chapters that our genes are written in. There's like more chapters in a bigger book. This is a distribution of how many exons, how many chapters are in all of the genes of the human genome. Huntington has 63 exons, it's out here. It's 6 times bigger than the average human gene. So it's huge, which makes it gnarly to work with in the lab, trust me, it's hard. If it was a little weed gene, it's easy to clone and move around and play with the DNA and not screw it up. We know this is like, nobody's ever seen this before. You guys are literally the first humans to see this. Huntington's is super important. We know that because when we make mice that don't have this gene, they die. They're not born, actually. But now we have really cool human data. So my friend Eric Minical, who works at the Broad Institute in Boston, is working on a project called the Exome Aggregation Consortium, where they're taking tens of thousands of people's DNA that have been sequenced, and they're just putting it in a big database. So you can go find really weird, really rare mutations, not in 1 people or 10 people or 100 people like we did in Venezuela, but in like 60,000 people. And when they do that, they can go and they can say, okay, how often do I find a mutant copy of that gene? Like somebody walking around, not with a CAG expansion, but just with some mutation that screws up their Huntington gene. Almost never. There's lots of genes that you can get mutations in and like, it's fine, you're okay. Huntington is in the top 10% of genes in our entire genome being resistant to that kind of mutation. You almost never find people with mutations that screw up their Huntington gene, which is really good evidence that there's something really important that this gene is doing, which, I mean, we kind of knew, but this is now human proof that that's true. Ed showed a picture of this. This is from Inchi Song at MGH. This is an actual picture of not the Huntington gene, but the protein that gets made from the gene. As Ed said, this is like 18 months ago, this first draft of what this protein kills brain cells and that causes Huntington's disease. No one has ever seen this protein before. It's incredibly revealing to be able to look at the shape of the thing that's causing all these problems. If you want to build a drug, right? If you want to say, oh, I want to make it not shaped bad so it doesn't kill cells anymore, it's really helpful to know what it actually looks like so you can design a drug to stick on it somewhere and fix it. No one was able to do this before. This was just 18 months ago. This was like yesterday. Rachel Harding, who's at the University of Toronto right now, who's trying to do even better, higher resolution pictures of the Huntington protein, is currently in Oxford right now, working with like one of the world experts on like protein shape. And she's doing this amazing project. You can follow along. At labscribbles.com, she's putting her actual like live day-to-day, like what I did in the lab today, online in real time. You can watch her experiments. And she's only working on HD. And she's working specifically on this problem, what is the shape of this thing? This is data that she did like 2 days ago. These are updated pictures. This is like three different views of the same thing of the mutant Huntington protein. These are so new that these are iPhone screenshots. She just took, with her iPhone, she just took a picture of the computer she's working on at Oxford right now. She said I could show them to you. So no one has ever, you guys are the first group of people besides Rachel and me to see this ever. This is what we think the mutant Huntington protein looks like. And now that we know, I think we'll get much better at designing therapies. Okay. The other really weird thing about Huntington's disease, and talking about all these, like, why haven't we fixed it yet, is that, as far as we know, homozygous people, the unfortunate rare people that inherit two mutant copies of the Huntington gene, do not get sick earlier than people who only have one mutant copy, which is the vast majority of Huntington's patients. If you have an explanation for that, I will buy you a beer, because I don't get it. I don't know why having one mutant copy of a gene is so terrible it causes Huntington's disease, but having two mutant copies is not any worse, as far as we can tell. Super weird. This is a this is a mural in a little tiny town called Edison, which is by where I live now, and it's a quote from Edward R. Murrow, the great American newscaster from World War II. And he had this quote, he said, anyone who isn't confused really doesn't understand the situation. The bottom line is that this is a really hard problem for a lot of really good reasons. We're not stupid, we're not dumb, we're not, this is a hard problem. Going from the mutant gene to the what? How do we fix it is a really tricky problem. The easiest thing to do, the best thing to do, and the thing that I go home and like am warm and fuzzy about is to just silence it. Turn it off. Who cares what it does? Who cares what its shape is? Who cares about any of that stuff? Let's just get rid of it. That's what the antisense trials are all about. That's what the next generation of trials behind that, with the zinc fingers and CRISPR and blah, blah, blah. That's what that's about, and it's awesome, because none of this other stuff matters. However, on the off chance that that's not effective, or that there's problems with that, I think we have to keep studying so we can come up with the next generation of drugs. So I don't want to be depressing is the point. This is a very difficult biological problem. There's a very easy way to solve it, which is to just silence the gene. And there's ways of doing that. So don't get bummed out by my, like, this is a hard problem slide. So what am I doing? What do you guys have left? So I've been studying, and you guys have been paying for it, whether you knew it or not. I've been studying Huntington's disease outside the brain. I just told you it's a brain disease, so that's like a weird thing to do, obviously. Sorry, the highlighting's weird. Since the 70s, there's been some rare like autopsy reports that peripheral organs, organs outside the brain, have changes in people with who died of Huntington's disease. Organs like the liver had some like subtle signs of degeneration or problems. This has been validated in more modern, cool, like fancy mass spectrometry techniques where people can actually look at how fast organs like the liver are burning energy, and they can say, oh, it's impaired. Actually, people who are pre-symptomatic mutation carriers. So there's changes happening in tissues outside of the brain. Who cares? Why study them? This is a brain disease. I agree with that. I'm a neuroscientist. So a couple reasons. One, bad things happening in non-brain tissues might send signals to the brain that actually makes HD worse. So there's evidence of diseases where like you screw up the liver and the brain gets screwed up. Okay, that could happen. Bad things happening in non-brain tissues might cause problems for patients, whether or not they have anything to do with the brain disease. We know muscle weakness is a problem in HD, and that might just be because the muscles are screwed up in part. So that's worth understanding. It's really hard to study what causes brain cells to die when they're dead. studying brain dead cells is not very interesting. They're dead, they're gone, right? We want to know how they got dead. So I would really rather study tissues that are on their way to dying than dead ones. So, and since the HPV gene is expressed in every tissue in the body, right? Brain cells do their brain cell thing, but liver cells do liver cell things, and pancreas cells do pancreas things. Maybe if we study those other roles that other cells do, we can learn about something the HD gene does because we can see how it changes those other roles that don't happen in brain cells. So my lab set out to study the first of these. I'm gonna summarize like 2 years worth of work in like 3 slides. If we silence HD outside of the brain, the HD gene, can we make the brain better? That was my first hypothesis. I'm a simple-minded guy. This is I literally show this live in science meetings because this is how I think about science. I'm very simple-minded. Here's a mouse. We have mice that have mutant HD gene like people. We have the antisense drugs, just like they're from the mouse gene, but they're otherwise essentially identical to the ones that are in human trials. And we can inject them, not into the cerebral spinal fluid like Ed talked about, but into the actual like body, into the intraperitoneal space, we call it. Point is, the blood-brain barrier that Ed mentioned doesn't let these molecules go back and forth. That's why you have to inject them into the spinal fluid to get them into the brain. So we took advantage and did the opposite. What if we silence Huntington in the body, the liver and the fat and the whatever, and will it make the brain better? Because if it did, that'd be really cool. So my really talented technician Sydney did this huge study of like 100 mice and silenced the Huntington in their peripheral organs and then went and looked at the brain. I just put this up here so I remember to say something. We looked at like 10,000 things in the brain, none of them got better. So it would have been really cool if it had worked. It didn't. She was really sad about this, and she said, so like, should we have done it? Like, who cares? Like, what was the point of this? And I think the point is that you can learn a lot by studying what happens when you get rid of the Huntington gene. So when we went back and we looked, this is just the weight of the mice, the actual body weight of the mice. When we silenced their Huntington gene, they started losing weight towards the end of their life. And when we looked, again, this is like not meant to like actually look at this data, but just say we looked at their liver in particular in a lot of different ways, and their livers look a bit sick. Not like necrotic, like they're falling out or whatever, but like they just don't look like super healthy livers. And so it could be that having Huntington expression in your liver is important for keeping a healthy liver. And if we ever test a therapy that targets not just the brain, but the whole body, and they're coming, I'd like to know ahead of time if people are going to have their livers fall out, you know, so they don't have HD, but now they don't have a liver. That'd be really nice to know before it happens in people. I mean, I love killing mice, but I'd rather kill mice than you guys and me. So we don't know why the livers are getting sick, and we now have this whole other study going on about this. There's also this really cool thing, and Ray Truman's going to talk a little bit later about this. Just to show you, like, when you do good studies, even if they don't work in quotes, you learn cool stuff sometimes. So everybody knows, so you have this long CAG track in your Huntington gene, that's what we call HD mutation. If the mice we have, we've given a really big one, like 130 CAG, so it's really big, long, repetitive stretch. And all we're doing here, this is like a DNA machine that's counting how big, so this is like 130 and then 129, 128, this is like counting how many cells have that number of CAGs. These are liver cells, and these are mice that we treated, just control mice, we didn't do anything to. Somebody's trying to get me off the stage.
Jeff, we can't see your pointer. When you're pointing at the screen there, we can't see the pointer here.
So everybody's just nodding and smiling at me? This whole time. You guys haven't been paying attention to
that. I was.
So this is just like a distribution of CAGs. So we took a whole bunch of liver cells and we measured how big their CAG is, and most of them are 130, but they those are better things. But they vary a little bit. That's normal because nothing in biology is like 100%. So what's really weird, and it happens in two places in the body: the striatum, the part of the brain that dies in Huntington's disease, and the liver. Only two tissues in the body that happens to this big of an extent. When you count how many CAGs they have in an old mouse, you find the normal CAG, the one that you gave them. But you also find this second peak of really long CAGs, like 200, 300, something like that. So they won't pass these on to their children because they're not mating with their liver cells. We call this somatic instability. The CAG tract actually gets longer in this tissue. Why? No idea. Does it matter? Maybe. anything that happens in the striatum, I'm interested in. And you can imagine that if having 42 CAGs is bad or 48 CAGs is bad, having 300 would be real, real bad. And there are some people, not all, some scientists who think that these really long CAG tracks that happen in cells might be make those cells especially vulnerable to dying. So when we treated livers with this antisense, a drug that knocks down the Huntington gene, I don't know if you can tell, I haven't done like statistics on this. I mean, I have, and it's true, but whatever. Does this peak look farther shifted that way?
Yeah.
It is. So when we silenced the Huntington gene in this tissue, we actually made their somatic instability better. Also have no idea why this happened. Because we weren't expecting this. This is just one of the things when you do a study and you follow it, you find these fun, cool findings. And there's some really compelling evidence coming from human genetic studies now saying that something about DNA maintenance and repair, the kind of processes that lead to this kind of shift in CAG size, might actually modulate the age of onset of human HD patients. So all of a sudden we're really interested in better understanding this. This is like a month old. We have no idea where this is going. But it's the kind of thing that you can do when you have the support of a foundation like this. You can say, let's keep studying these tissues. So for all of these reasons, for the it's really important reason and for the we have human gene silencing studies, my lab has become really interested in understanding what happens when you get rid of the Huntington gene. So we're spending a lot of energy. We've now made mice that don't have Huntington gene in only their liver, and mice that don't have Huntington gene only in their fat cells, and now we're going to study how those mice live and try to understand better about what's happening with the HD gene. So we were doing that study, and I had some other studies I wanted to do, and I asked you guys for some money via the New Pathways program, because I wanted to follow up on another one of these ideas, which was that maybe if we study like other cell types that do other stuff, we can learn more about what the HD gene's normal role is in cells. And the basic idea is like, okay, well, we don't have to study these guys that are sick and dying. Let's take like the relatively healthy tissue, like the liver, and then we can like tweak it and see what happens to the mouse when they're Huntington is over in their liver. So I always show this slide of like the mouse. I put this here. So I asked and applied for some funding, and you guys injected $139,000 worth of money into not just this one mouse, but into a lot of mice. And my very talented technician, Bobby Bragg, isolated liver cells from these mice. And what we did is that we had fed the mice from their first day of life with three different diets. And mice are cool because you can mess with them and they do what you say. And so we gave them a normal diet, or like a fatty diet, or like an even fatter diet. It's the kind of thing people do when they study liver to look at what happens to body weight gain and things like that. So we have these three different groups of mice: normal food, fat food, American food, right? It's literally called a Western type diet, I'd say. And we isolate their cells, and then we can do things to those cells, like give tracers to them and see how much sugar they're burning and all that kind of stuff. And this was the platform that we never would have got off the ground if it hadn't been for the support of the HSC. This is body weight, I don't know why I'm showing this. Surprise, if you feed mice greasy, fat food, they get fat. Right. Good science. This is more interesting, and again, no one's ever seen this before, but it's like family, so I can show you. Who's ever had a glucose tolerance test? Like where you drink like a bunch of sugar and then they check your blood sugar? We do this in mice, and so there's this interesting thing. So these peaks are just like glucose in the blood of the mice, and the colors are the genotype. So green is our HD mice, and the little orange color is the normal mice. And what we found is that normal mice fed regular food, they're normal. Like they don't have any, HD mice don't have any alterations in their blood sugar handling. But when we really push the system, we feed them super high fat, they have impaired glucose, like a little bit diabetic kind of. Only the HD mice. So there's a specific vulnerability in the HD mice to this high fat feeding, which kind of says that they're dealing with the stress of high fat food differently than normal mice. So it suggests that we weren't so wrong anyway about the hypothesis that maybe HD cells, maybe they'll look okay at baseline, but if you really push the system, right, make it deal with like a big insult, in this case a lot of fat, you can see differences, which I'll tell you why that's cool in a second. So we can do really sophisticated ways of saying like how much energy are these cells burning? So a little change in, oh, I keep doing that. Someone holler at me if I'm like doing that. Let me do this. These are the normal mice, and these are HD mice, and the color is like regular fat, fatty fat, and fatty fat fat. And all we're measuring here is, we put labeled sugar in there, in the media above the cell, and we're just measuring. I really cut off. Is it off? Can I use this guy? Can you hear me now? Basically all we're doing here is we're actually just measuring that sugar. So we put in the cells, did we give all the cells the same amount of sugar? And the answer is, you don't have, I mean, I'm not that much of a scientist either. Yeah, that looks reasonable, right? Like they all have the same amount of sugar in their system. But then if we, that's how I think about science. Question two, if we don't look at the sugar, we look at CO2, carbon dioxide, which is like what you make when you burn sugar, it's like the ultimate product of the sugar. Are they making the same amount? And here what you can see is in the normal mice, the diet, this high-fat diet induces this huge change. So initially they're burning tons and tons of sugar with healthy cells when they're eating a low-fat diet. When we feed them a high-fat diet, they're not burning that much sugar at all. And that change is not reflected. The HD cells don't change at all. It's like they can't tell what's happening in their environment. So there's this really interesting diet. Talk amongst yourselves. Just check my email.
Yeah.
Someone's videoing a guy like in my butt a long time. So the point of this is this. My background here. We have this hypothesis that looking at HD cells under stress might show us they react differently, and they do. And if we hadn't been able to grow all these different diets with all these different conditions, we would have never been able to see that. And these are really healthy cells. These are like liver cells, which are fine. They're really robust. It's kind of hard to kill liver, thank God. It's not personal. We're looking at them before they die, before they're ever sick at all. And the fact that they have this dramatic change in how, it doesn't even matter what this is, but the dramatic change in how they're handling eating sugar says that the way those cells are built somehow or responding to the environment is different. And to me, I find that really interesting. I can't put any more stuff on here. So our conclusion is that the liver cells that you guys enable us to study don't respond in the same way to an increase in dietary fat, which we just chose as a model way to like push the system, to kind of insult the system. And it suggests there's some change in how those cells process information, how they sense fat, how they respond to it. And the good thing is those pathways of how cells do that, any cell, are pretty well worked out. And it mostly has to do with turning on and off the right kind of genes that you need deal with digesting a bunch of fat. So we were able to follow up the study, and I won't go into details, but we were able to follow it up by looking at these changes in sort of the genetic program that cells have to turn on to burn fat. And we found that HD cells are really bad at doing it. And we brought in some really sophisticated computational people who, you know, never would have maybe been working on this problem except that we had this money to get these cells, and we were able to start this kind of ball rolling. And these really great people like Seth Ament, who's actually just moved to the University of Maryland, who set up his own lab, is going to keep working on HD because these are really cool problems. And it also lets us identify really specific targets for fixing it. So I know I have to shut up here in just a second. I actually would like to take a few questions, so I'm going to try to shut up 5 minutes ahead of time by just finishing and saying, so here's where we're at. We've generated, I mean, preliminary, we don't understand it completely, but we've generated data consistent with our idea, which is that HD cells are different than normal cells, even before they're sick. And there's ways that you can push those systems to try to untangle them, right? To dig into the cells and figure out what's going different, and ultimately to find what's different, how the mutant HD gene is influencing it. And once you have data, people like you better, And you guys, all I have is an idea, and you gave me some money and let me try it out, and we got some really cool data. And the CHDI Foundation just signed up to give us another $1.7 million to really take this forward in an impressive way. And that never would have happened if we didn't have the early data that we were able to generate thanks to your guys' brave investment in some idiot. This is Western Washington University in this horrible hill overlooking this beautiful bay and island. It's terrible to go there. My lab's like over here. My lab's like right on that little green home. And there's lots of people that help me, and they're great. So thank you guys. Until 2:45, and if we do, I'm happy to take a couple questions. I'm happy to take questions regardless. I don't care about the time.
Have you ever been
a host
on a ketogenic diet?
So ketogenic, has everybody heard of ketogenic diet? It's weird. If you, like paleo people, like if you go super low carb, so... That's a Carroll. Back to the mic. If you don't eat carbs, your brain starves because your brain only eats sugar. And so your body has this weird thing it can do if you have no sugar in your blood, that your liver will actually start to digest itself, whatever's there, fat, protein, whatever, and actually make something called ketone bodies, which aren't really bodies, they're just little sugar-like compounds that get used to feed the brain. And it's been known since literally Greek times that if you starve people or of carbs, that you put them in this ketogenic state, that kids with epilepsy will have less severe epilepsy. So it was clear that starving people and making this weird thing happen is good for your brain. And it turns out it's actually good not just for epilepsy, it's good for lots of brain stuff. And people have done various kinds of caloric restriction like that in mouse models, and it's almost universally makes them better. So starving mouse models makes them better. This is complicated for HD patients because they have problems, like human HD problems, patients have problems with their metabolism. So it might be riskier to take an HD patient and starve them than it is a lab mouse that's really controlled. So I don't recommend that people try it, but definitely in mice it works, and we should understand why, because maybe we can make a better drug. It also proves that like there's crosstalk right between the body and the brain. Other questions? I'm just gonna take questions until someone comes and kicks me off. Oh, she's walking towards the stage. Quiet ass down.
Could you explain
So the question is, how do we silence a gene? Like, how do we do it in the liver? There's a bunch of ways of doing it now. There wasn't, like, when I started my PhD, this is all pretty new stuff. The technology that we're using, in the studies that I described to you is antisense, which is the name of the molecules that are made by this company called Ionis, among others. And they're basically, like, they're like, what we call them 20 mers. They're, like, short 20 base pair long bits of DNA that's heavily chemically modified to make it more stable and get through your cell membranes and do what it needs to do. And that base, that sequence, the 20 bases of sequence matches the Huntington gene. And it goes into your cells and it binds to the, not the DNA, but the RNA, which is the step between the DNA and the protein, and it binds to it. And when your cells see double-stranded RNA, they don't like it, because human cells don't have it, and mostly, and so they degrade it because they think it's like an invading bacteria or virus or something. And so it's basically we're like hacking the cell's defenses to, instead of targeting like a bacterial gene or a viral gene, to target and destroy whatever gene we wanted to, in this case the Huntington gene.
Hi,
is that 2 minutes? Okay.
Jeff, you said that knocking out the HD through gene silencing is the solution. But yet, I read a lot of the stuff in HD Plus, and that doesn't seem that's absolutely true.
We're optimistic at HD Plus. It's not, the question was, you say that silencing is the answer, but it seems like it's not always 100% confident on HD buzz. I think what we may say sometimes about gene silencing for HD and HD buzz is that it's just complications we don't know about. Like I said, getting rid of the Huntington gene completely from birth, like from development, is terrible for mice. That's not happening in human trials. Not getting to zero. Nothing. No drug works 100%, right? So these silencing drugs aren't effective enough in a way, which is kind of good, to get the Huntington gene suppressed so low that it's toxic. We don't think. They're certainly not in monkeys and rodents. We don't know in humans because we're only doing it now for the first time. But I think all the safety stuff that could have been done has been done. And there's questions about whether, you know, how well tolerated it's going to be, whether there's going to be a side effect. That's why we do trials. But I'm optimistic every single day. As a backup option to silencing all of Huntington in case that's toxic, remember, almost everyone with a Huntington's disease patient has one mutant and one normal copy. There's ways of targeting just the mutant copy for silencing and not the regular one. And in a perfect world, that would be better. Like, just get rid of the mutant one and not the other one. It's harder to do for lots of reasons, and it excludes some people from the trials, which I can talk to people afterwards. So this first trial of silencing both is an experiment, and I hope it will work. I'm genuinely optimistic and happy about it. If I ever see otherwise, I'm just being cautious. I think, is that my time? Okay, thanks guys.